Chapter 4. The view from the cockpit wasn't much to look at. S&R Black floated parallel to Mira. The 500 meters separating the two ships felt as though it was too far and not far enough. The ship creeped him out. He'd seen the hollow feeds of the strange pinecone-like objects clinging to the hull, the broken and fractured deck plates, and the curious damage to its aft. He kept track of the feeds from the starboard side cameras, showing him the firing of the stabilization jets Gunny's squads had affixed to the giant ship. S&R Black's AI, simply known as Black, had handled the firing sequence to minimize damage to their mission target, but Oakes had been more than a little interested to see how that process went. After all, if one of the stabilization packs malfunctioned, debris could rebound straight at S&R Black as though shot from a cannon. After the jets fired, pieces of hull, decking, and who knew what else, spewed into space as if Mira had vomited. Luckily for him, the largest hazards flew from Mira's starboard side, far away from S&R Black. He'd still have to monitor the area, but for now, at least, he needed to focus on one thing, finding the source of the communications interference. Corporal Callie Moore's squad, consisting of Lance Corporals Elliot, Dickerson, and Carbonaro, was somewhere aboard the derelict. Communications with the squad were in a complete blackout. Black had received a signal from Kalimura's block, and the AI was certain that she, at least, had survived the wreck of their skiff. But since the energy pulse from Mira, long-range communication was spotty at best. Even if Kalimura found a way to send a signal, he wasn't sure they'd pick it up through the interference. Noble, the ship's engineer, had already headed to his diagnostic console in the bowels of the ship. He and the AI were trying to determine if a small radiation leak was responsible for the interference. Oakes very much doubted that it was. So did Noble. Black, a little odd since its software upgrade on Titan Station, had thought it a long shot too, but didn't have any other suggestions. Oakes shivered. He'd worked with Black for as long as he'd been assigned to the ship. The AI, barely sentient, but serviceable, had always been friendly, diligent, and logical. But since the upgrade? Well, something wasn't right with her. Black spoke more like, well, a human. No, that wasn't right. More sentient. More like the Trident Station AIs known as the Trio. Those AIs were much closer to human than Oakes liked, and now Black acted very much like them. He swiped away the starboard cam feeds and replaced them with energy scans of the immediate area. Oakes felt as though he'd already done this 100 times, but hell, what else did he have to do? The captain was behind him, presumably catching up on diagnostic reports, calculating their next steps, and dealing with messages from Colonel Hayes back on Trident Station. Until the captain gave him something better to do, tracking down the interference was the only responsible use of his time. Sighing, Oakes stared at the control board. He'd already scanned for heat, bursts of cosmic radiation, and the standard battery of usual jamming frequencies. Nothing. One astronomical unit from Pluto, they were the only ship out here. Apart from Mira, nothing human-made shared their space, and Mira was as lifeless as an asteroid, at least when it came to energy readings. Oakes frowned. Radar, laser, all his sensors said no signals. Christ, what was he missing? What frequencies could he possibly test now? He initiated a private block connection to Black.
Yes, Lieutenant,
the AI said in his mind. What am I missing? I've tried nearly everything here. The AI paused.
Perhaps nearly isn't enough.
Oakes rolled his eyes. Before the upgrade, he'd never wanted to punch Black in her virtual face. But now, it was an urge during every one of their conversations. Are you suggesting something?
Yes, Lieutenant,
the AI said in a flat, emotionless tone.
Sensor logs indicate you were thinking in terms of an enemy.
Of course I am, Oakes said. It wasn't present in the AI's words, but Oakes felt Black's frustration through the intimate connection.
The Kuiper Belt has no human enemies for you to scan,
she said.
The Kuiper Belt is filled with objects of various compositions that may be the remnants of Sol System's creation. However, it is likely some of these bodies are exosolar in nature, and therefore their composition is impossible to guess. Regardless, the majority of Kuiper Belt objects haven't been surveyed, even by the Pluto Exo Observatory.
Oakes didn't sigh out loud, but through the connection. Your point?
My point, Lieutenant, is that you need to abandon your preconceptions as to both the source of the interference as well as the type.
Source, type. You said various compositions. Like what? The AI seemed to smile. The sensation sent a shiver up his spine.
Ice. Various gases frozen into objects of differing sizes and formation. Previous studies indicate the presence of frozen methane, water, and ammonia.
He blinked. I don't see how any of those could generate interference.
Correct,
Black said.
While the majority of KBOs may be ice, that is not to say they all are. Before PEO began surveying the belt more than 70 years ago, it was unknown that the belt's size is hardly finite, as new objects seem to appear in the belt now and again.
From where? He asked. Black paused.
Unknown,
it said.
Humankind lacks the number of observatories necessary to ascertain when new arrivals appear, let alone their source or composition. A new KBO could arrive this very moment, and PEO would be unaware of it for days, months, or longer. By the time a KBO is trapped in Sol's gravitational field, their incoming trajectory is forever lost.
Oakes tapped a finger on the chair's arm. He understood what the AI was getting at, but that didn't exactly help with an explanation. Let's try again, he said. KBOs might have exosolar origins.
Yes,
Black said. And if they are, there is no telling what their composition is.
Correct,
the AI said.
And without exhaustive sensor readings, as well as physical samples, it is impossible to guess whether or not their outer shells are indicative of their core.
Shit, he mumbled aloud. Rolling his eyes, he looked backward at Dunn to make sure the captain hadn't heard him. Dunn was busy with his own private holo display. Okay, he told the AI. Then let's think of the asteroid belt. Most asteroids are composed of metal.
Yes,
the AI said. So what's to say a KBO can't have metallic components as well? We can't rule it out.
That is correct, Lieutenant,
Black said.
But you're also thinking too small.
Frustrated, Oakes growled low in his throat. He felt the AI bristle at the emotion. Black, I liked it better when you stopped asking leading questions and just told me what the fuck was going on.
This,
the AI said,
is not fact. This is conjecture, and therefore I'm merely preparing you for my less than factual conclusions.
Well then, he said in his mind, get on with it.
Centuries-old theoretical models predicted new elements with atomic numbers well beyond what humankind has thus far observed. Couple that concept with theoretical stable isotopes of common elements, not thus far observed, then it's possible that both theories are true in the context of exosolar material.
He blinked. Very interesting, Black, but unless I'm mistaken, you're not exactly outfitted with sensors to find new elements.
Sadly, no,
the AI said.
However, I do have sensors capable of finding traces of more common elements such as oxygen, carbon, ferrous metals, and a slew of other compounds used to create munitions as well as interplanetary craft such as myself.
Then we're looking for something that doesn't fit expectations.
Correct,
Black said.
Jamming radio waves isn't difficult. However, my sensors show no evidence of jamming our most commonly used communication methods.
And we're not experiencing significant cosmic ray radiation, Oakes said, so we can rule that out.
Agreed,
Black said.
However, I believe we are looking for something in that spectrum.
Oakes tilted his head. Please elaborate. He felt Black take the AI equivalent of a breath. He'd felt Portunas do that before, but never the ship's AI.
The PEO AI, Mickey, first detected Mira via its distress signal. However, one of the telescopes caught a burst of light emanating from Mira. Mickey proposed the source of the anomaly to be the result of light reflecting from Pluto. The trio is in full agreement that this is not only unlikely, but close to impossible.
And what did the trio propose?
They didn't,
Black said.
However, while we traveled from Trident Station to Pluto, the trio put forth a theory that the light burst was due to a mass release of photons. Source unknown. I would say we just witnessed another such burst.
Oakes frowned. So this isn't the first time Mira has spat out this kind of radiation?
No,
Black agreed.
However, my sensors have detected no such radiation since we arrived in the outer Kuiper Belt. Although the phenomenon may be cyclical in nature, its frequency is not known.
Mass release of photons. That sounded like a nuclear explosion or a reactor meltdown to Oaks. Black, the damage done to Mira's aft section, is there any way of knowing when it occurred? He felt the AI hesitate through the mental connection.
There should be,
Black said.
But I will have to think on that.
Fine, Oaks said. Meanwhile, I'm going to run some sensor sweeps in that area. Maybe the evidence is behind us rather than around us.
Good suggestion,
Black said.
If you need assistance, do not hesitate to ask.
He terminated the Black connection. His back hurt. He realized he'd hunched forward during the conversation with Black as though he'd been in a shouting match. Forcing himself to lean back, he uttered a low sigh of relief. Without Black's presence in his mind, he could finally concentrate. The AI wasn't as helpful as she'd been on previous trips. Oaks wondered if he shouldn't stop relying upon her for anything. He turned in his chair to look at the captain. Dunn was still lost in his own private holo display. He opened his mouth to speak and then stopped himself. He turned back to his own display with a frown. Best to be sure. He'd run the diagnostics himself. He'd run the sensor sweeps. He'd do it all as manually as he could and then ask Black to do it again. He'd compare the results. Then he'd tell the captain. Let's find that interference, he said to no one and dived back in to the holo display.